session for the Norfolk City Council will now commence. Dr. Fiala, the floor is yours.
Thank you, sir. This evening, we've got a pretty full open agenda, but we also have a pretty full closed agenda. And I think we've had to punt a couple items from closed agendas in the previous weeks that now we need to act on. So in the interest of time, I'm going to recommend that the body goes into closed session. We do our closed session business, and then we come out.
All right, before you do that, let's make sure that we are
on camera.
Yes.
Are we beaming?
Yeah, I don't see the evidence that we are, but we will.
We trust that we shall verify.
It was rehearsal. We got to do it again.
Michael Marks, way of retirement.
I would recommend to council that we go into closed session and then come out for open session.
Thank you. Mr. Bull.
I move that the members of the council assemble informally in closed meeting on June 28, 2022 at 4:05 p.m. in the 10th floor conference room of the City Hall building of the City of Norfolk for the purposes which are settled in clauses 1 and 29 of subsection A of section 2.2-3711 of the Virginia Freedom of Information Act as amended. Clause 1, discussion of prospective candidates for vacant boards, commission authority, and committee appointments. Clause 29, discussion of the award of a public contract with the open time for discussion of open session would adversely affect negotiating strategy of the public body. Mrs. Doyle.
Aye.
Mrs. Johnson.
Aye.
Ms. McClellan.
Aye.
Mr. Riddick.
Aye.
Ms. Royster.
Aye.
Mr. Speed.
Aye.
Mr. Thomas.
Aye.
Dr. Alexander.
Aye.
Thank you, sir. I want to start this evening with our Parks and Rec Master Plan update. We've got Mr. Neelay Bhatt back with us. Mr. Bhatt and his team have been working on the Master Plan, Parks and Rec Master Plan update over about the last year now, I guess. We're approaching a year. We've got some updates to the plan. I think we presented some of the items before. This evening we've got a handful of what I would say would be goals and recommendations and ideas. So without further, I want to bring up Mr. Bhatt and his team. Thanks for being here again, sir. Or Daryl, do you want to introduce the group? Yeah, go ahead. I'll let Daryl introduce the consulting group.
Everything the city manager said. Good afternoon, good evening, Mr. Mayor, City Council members, Mr. Manager. It's with great pleasure we bring back to you Neelay Bhatt
of Pros Consulting. Today he's going to actually give his final presentation with hopes of adoption of a new master plan, which will chart the future of parks and recreation over the next 10 years. So without further ado, I want to introduce Mr. Neelay Bhatt.
So he's been practicing this intro for the last 2 hours, so you did well. Just testing the clicker works. Okay, wonderful. Okay, so a little more than a year in the works, you know, obviously started in the pandemic as well. And as Daryl said, this is a roadmap for the future, right? You're not a broken agency that needs to be fixed. Before we started the plan, you were already a gold medal finalist. As of a few days ago, you've been reaccredited to join a group of less than 200 out of 12,000 agencies that have been, one, achieving that recognition, and even fewer that have actually gotten 100% score in that. So this is more about, we weathered, you know, tough times in the pandemic, and you've seen harder than most others around the country, how challenging it can be. So this plan is, again, a vision to continue building forward on the things you all were doing, both internally with the staff and the culture, and externally with the community at large. So a quick reminder and a recap in terms of just where Norfolk as a population is headed. Population, to some degree, has been and will continue to age. I refuse to call them seniors. They don't behave like it, but it's active adults. The 55-plus population, that's the blue and the red on the right-hand side, is going to be about more than one in four people, about 28% of the population, up from only 19% in the years past. At the same time, we are shrinking in the under 18 population to some degree, and 18 to 34 as well, but we still have a lot of young families and kids. So the balance of intergenerational offerings for families, for the youth, as well as for the active adults is going to be key. At the same time, you all know this better than I do, socioeconomics. We're not Virginia Beach. And for many people, parks and recreation might be the only access they have to recreation. So balancing fiscal sustainability with equity of access is something we've been focused on throughout this plan. Benchmarking, and this is on a curve. So we looked at agencies that are all, for the most part, gold medal winners or finalists, barring a couple of them. What you do see, though, in terms of the population per square mile, we are by far the most heavily populated. Lesser land, we've got to be more judicious with the planning and what we do as well from that standpoint. But these are the ones we compared ourselves against. And I have two salient points I want to bring up here. One, if you look at the number of indoor recreation facilities, we have a lot of them, and yet we are, in terms of the average size, the second smallest of them all. We have a lot of really small buildings. And that's not the way things are going across the country in terms of multi-use, in terms of intergenerational access, and frankly, in terms of the cost of operations on a per square foot basis. Every agency that is as good as you are and comparable to you is moving towards larger spaces. In addition, as we think of the operating expense per resident, we spend less than $72 or less than $6 per resident per month. Given today's gas prices, that's basically a little more than a gallon of gas per resident for an entire park system. That's not sustainable. Right, that is significantly underserved as well. And as you see, even the median, which is 50%, is over $74. So we are, despite all of this, you all have still managed to be a gold medal finalist. And that's testament to all of you and the staff here. Couple quick snapshots. In general, we had to pivot like everybody else with the pandemic and move to a lot of virtual mechanisms. But staff did an absolutely phenomenal job where we got input from close to 1,500 participants through a statistically valid survey, almost 800 people in an online survey, almost 450 in a statistically valid survey, key leaders, staff, stakeholder interviews, and an ADA-accessible, multilingual, mobile-friendly website called Keeping You First. All of these put together were key in ensuring that anybody at any time that wanted to be a part of the process and share their input had a chance to do so. Quick snapshot of the online survey, like we mentioned, it was available for almost 2 months. In addition, the statistically valid survey was administered by mail, phone, and web through an independent firm, ETC Institute. All the scientific mumbo-jumbo, the last bullet really just means that for us to come back to you and say, this represents your community in a scientific, random, and anonymous way, I have to be able to show that the results you see here are defensible and replicable. And what this tells me is that 95 out of 100 times, the results I'm about to share with you are in a margin of error of plus or minus 4.6%. The demographics match the demographics of the city from a race and ethnicity, gender, age standpoint as well. So this truly was a microcosm of Norfolk's population. Some key things here, right? Top one, why people don't participate, they don't have the features and amenities we want in the parks. Now, we drove by Lafayette today, and I already see construction and things happening, which is great. We're talking of a rec center and a library and all that, so yes, you are certainly moving in that direction already. But look at choice number three. The first choice will cost us hundreds of thousands, if not millions of dollars, to add amenities, facilities, parks. Three is simply communication. Over 40% of your respondents said the reason they don't come to programs, this is pre-pandemic, is not because you don't offer them or they are poor, but they just don't know what you have. And so that, to me, if we think of equity of access and participation, that's the lowest hanging fruit for us, is getting the word out in ways people want to know about. Right? Even different age groups have different preferences for social media. Right? An older demographic would look at Facebook, versus Instagram versus TikTok. And so those are some of the things in terms of lack of awareness for us to keep in mind. In addition, we asked what are people most willing to fund, right? This is a key question because if you ask people, what do you want? No matter where I am, they'll say all of this. What do you want to pay for? None of this. So the question is balancing the two. And as much as some of the things you see on the top, walking, biking trails, waterfront, every plan you've done, you all know this already. That's always a high priority. New trails, nature-based focus, outdoors, really important. Third one is key for Norfolk. They want you to improve what you have, your existing neighborhood and your community parks. And the fourth is new indoor rec centers. So if I think of, again, the top four major things, it's trails and connectivity, access to nature, and new rec centers, along with fixing and upgrading just what you currently have. Equally tellingly, it's way down the list for a sports complex or a facility. That is not a high community priority right now, based on what people are willing to fund. Very, very encouraging, even amidst the pandemic. Over 50% of your respondents said, based on their perception of the value for parks, recreation trails, open space, it has somewhat or significantly increased. Less than 20% said it has reduced. And even this number is high, and I suspect here it is in part because we had facility closures that people felt I didn't have access to it, not because they don't value it. And the second, the question after this will show you exactly that. Based on the perception of value, how would you want things to be funded? Almost 2 out of 3 people said increase funding for parks and recreation. Less than 2%, which is half that of them, literally the margin of error, have said reduce funding. So your community values parks, recreation, trails, open space, all that you do, and they want to increase funding towards it, and they're indicating the kinds of things that they would want these to be funded. So then the question becomes, what's the priority? So we look at two of these. One was for programs, the others was facility amenity. Now the key with the way these questions were phrased, they were given a choice of 30 plus different variables. Initially it was asked, do you have a need for something, yes or no? If you have a need, to what extent is your need being met? 100%, 75, 50, 25, or 0? Anyone that says I have a need and my need is met at 50% or less, that is an unmet need. For the same thing they were asked, is this important to you? So as I've told all of you before, in Norfolk, cricket is a huge unmet need. That's important to 5 people. So it's not a community priority. On the other hand, sports fields or dog parks are important to a lot of people, but they're not a huge unmet need. So that's where the combination of what is important and from that what is unmet is really what becomes a priority. And that's where you can see adult fitness and wellness, senior health and wellness make up 2 of the top 3, sandwiched by exercise classes, followed by water fitness and lap swimming, and special events. So if you think of it, you know, and to some degree, maybe even special events, but otherwise, 4 of the top 5 highest program priorities, you are literally building a facility right now that's going to address every one of them, from aquatics to recreation to fitness and wellness-based offerings. And that's the key, is how do programs drive facility design? Same question for park facility amenities, walking, biking trails and beaches, no surprise. Fitness and indoor pools, identical to the programmatic needs we just heard as well, followed by neighborhood parks, indoor walking, jogging track and community centers, among many other things. Fourth from the bottom is large sports complex and other sports fields. Again, these are low because, as I said, they may be important, but they are not unmet needs for the community. So the level of service is where we started capturing what do you have, what do you provide in conjunction with the school, so ultimately, what does the community have access to, and in light of that, what should the need be for the future? So from the left, you see the different park types, you see what the school provides, you see what we provide. Based on that, we have a certain current level of service. Now, there is no standard for national practices for a recommended level. Everything is tailored to Norfolk based on the survey demographics, trends, and your whatever your community said. So using as those recommended levels of service the areas of biggest needs, park acreage, trail miles, and the two at the bottom, indoor recreation and indoor aquatic space. There are a couple of other one-offs as well with respect to a skate park or outdoor pool or splash pad as well as amenities. Now this gives us a good sense though in terms of quantity, but not in terms of access. So this can tell me how much. What we did next talked about where, so that again, everyone in the city has access to a quality offering no matter where they are. This is huge. On one hand, I want to commend you because nationally, 55% of the respondents have access to a park in a 10-minute walk. In Norfolk, that's 75%. You are 20% higher than national averages. And yet, over 60,000 people today don't have access to anything within a 10-minute walk. So therein lies the opportunity in terms of how do we maximize access for the others. These are some of the maps just to give you a sample in terms of distribution currently. So as you look at this, the dot in the center is the actual location. The ring around it basically shows how far out each amenity is served. Neighborhood parks, community parks, you still see some gaps here or there. Now you see significant gaps. Now you see no gaps. And this gives you a good sense of where we have significant gaps or overlaps. And this is where the idea in terms of repositioning or redesigning these to be something else is going to be important. You can't possibly afford to maintain as much as you have and do it in a good way. So what does this do in terms of decision for the future? Fewer, better quality, and yet ensuring access. That's where these maps will help us a lot. Tennis courts, basketball courts full and half, dog parks. For a city your size, I don't know any place that has these many dog parks, fenced or unfenced in the country, right? We do have quite a few, and that's where, again, the map does demonstrate in terms of overlaps, but also gaps. Splash pads, we mentioned in the inventory, we have gaps. You can see that here as well, right? More and more, these water features are far more inexpensive, better during the hot summer months as well, and easy to access for everybody. Outdoor pools, and then indoor recreation space. Now, at first glance, you might say, we have a lot. But this goes back to what I showed you in the benchmark. You have a lot of very small circles. So you have the existence of buildings, but not functional in terms of what they can provide, and not financially sustainable in terms of how you can staff them. So the idea would be, as you look at some of these as well, is where are there opportunities for us to be able to look at ensuring there is still sustained access, but ensure that the rings get bigger so I don't have to be sitting there watching my child play. I can have my child be in the gym while I'm walking in an elevated walking track around it. Or as a family, there are intergenerational opportunities for us to do things. So that all put together led to the visioning process. Daryl and his entire team, we spent over half a day. We had Ms. Pope as well make an appearance too, and she was part of this for a while with us and gave some direction. This is what everything started off with, right? Core values. At the end of the day, staff said, first and foremost, everything we do has to be community driven. We have to be diverse, equitable, inclusive, and at the same time, innovative as well to sustain the gold medal and the excellence you all have pursued. We want to be stewards both of the environment and of the public's finances. And ultimately, we are a choice. Everybody today can stay at home and watch Netflix and Disney Plus or be on this, or they can come to the Parks and Rec offerings. So we have to ensure we have fun and make that something that is an experience for everyone. These values led to the vision. I see around the country, Daryl, Ed, your team, you all are looked at as national leaders in terms of staff. You're looked at as a national leader in terms of the department. The last 2 years, notwithstanding with the changes we've had. What we have to continue focus on is the fact that we are not a nice to have additional offering. We are a necessary, essential experience because Parks and Rec has and does change lives. So that's really the vision that the department wants to continue working towards. And the mission for what they want to do every single day is very simple, to keep people first, to keep every single person in mind as they think of the offerings they do because ultimately it's not about parks or playgrounds or programs. It's just about people. And people we saw, when we don't have people in the parks, they mean nothing. People make the place ultimately. And that's what this team has always acknowledged and is working towards. So some quick examples of recommendations, and this is really what the action plan is. This is staff's marching orders, if you would, as you think of some specific guidelines for short, mid, and long term, up to 3 years, 3 to 5 years, and then beyond. The reason this is as an actionable recommendation is this is meant to be a living, breathing document. In January 2020, the master plan I finished could not have imagined how much the world would change in 60 days. What we want to ensure is that your plan continues to adapt as trends, as needs, as the community evolves and changes. A trails plan with emphasis on connectivity and access, especially to the water, that was one of the top priorities from the community. Better and continuing to activate the water, you have a great asset here. That's what the community wants. These are some specific priorities that came up in conversation with the visioning for the staff, specific to parks, beaches, trails, and forestry. As we look in terms of facility or programs, you talked about this even before the pandemic, you've heard me say this right now, how do you continue assessing your rec centers for overlap and moving towards this hub and spoke, some larger regional, some smaller neighborhood-based model as well? And how do you align your pools and rec centers to ensure equity of access? It's not just providing more of something, it's ensuring they are equitable in how people get to access them across the city. Staffing, this is internal, but absolutely critical, because you cannot afford to build all of these new things without a proportionate increase in your staffing and operations and maintenance resources. So what does that staffing plan look like? There isn't an agency in the country today that isn't struggling to either recruit or retain people. Every single place. People go where they're valued. People stay where they feel like they belong. And so what does that staffing plan look like, focusing on the culture, focusing on succession planning, salary analysis, and I know you've already done some adjustments working towards lifeguards on the staff as well. You saw in two of the survey options, lack of awareness is huge. For a gold medal finalist in a city your size, I can probably count on the fingers of one hand how many do not have an in-house dedicated marketing and communications position. This is a critical piece as well to let more people know of who you are, what you do, and what you stand for as well. So that's a critical piece too. And then funding, you know, your branding guide, part of it is recognizing we've gone from RPOS to parks and recreation. Funding and marketing is going to be key. In all the work we've done around the country, we've seen that a dollar spent on marketing or branding results in about $7 to $11 of a return on investment due to increased participation because of increased awareness. So marketing and branding is not an expense, it really is an investment that the best agencies continue to do. And looking at what the community's perceptions are going forward, right? This is an ongoing piece. You all know this better than anybody. In the last couple of years, even more so. It doesn't matter what you do, half the people are going to be unhappy. But getting a sense of where the community's priorities are, what they feel with respect to our culture, the values of the department, is going to be really, really critical. So all this leads to the legacy of this plan. If you look back in 5 and 10 years, this is what you would hope that the master plan would achieve. And this is just alphabetically listed. So regional recreation centers for intergenerational and multipurpose use. Blueways and trail connectivity. Right? Access to the water came up very high. Walking, biking were huge priorities too. Internally, what is your story? What is your why? What does Parks and Recreation stand for every single day? A culture, right? You know, continuing to build and endure the culture that retains, recruits the best of the best, because ultimately, you're only as good as your people. And at Disney, one of the things I learned was that your front line is your bottom line. So the way you treat your people is the way they're going to treat the customers outside. And lastly, inclusion and equity of access. How do we maximize that, whether it's the park, it's your facilities, it's your beaches, your trails, all of that as well. So these are the 5 high-level items that 15 months of work, all the community input, everything really boils down to this essence. to say ultimately to have the Norfolk that is the residence, the choice for residents or people and business to live, work, and play. These are the things that people look at now. If I can work and live anywhere, why would I be in Norfolk? And this is a huge part of that story. So I want to thank you all for the opportunity to come back to you and present and to get to work with this fantastic team. We have some next steps, and I'm open to answering questions and take your feedback.
Thank you very much. Let me ask a question about the sportsplex.
Yes, sir.
I wasn't clear on your reasoning for saying that residents didn't want it if they had to pay for it, the big sportsplex. So they if they didn't have to pay, it's something that they would find value in it, but they didn't want to pay for the sportsplex.
No, so let me rephrase. So for sports facilities in general, so just sports fields rather, I would say, diamond fields or rectangular fields, they were important, but not an unmet need, which means they didn't want more of those. In terms of where they wanted the city to spend the money, so projects to be funded, a sports complex was low on their priorities of the kind of project that should be funded by the city. Not simply for them to pay as user fee, but for the city to allocate dollars towards that specific project, if you would, in comparison with the others, right? It's always a zero-sum game. So it's not to say that this by itself is or isn't important, but if you give me a choice of trails and upgrading my parks and building rec centers and sports fields, then that's the lowest priority for me to fund. Does that answer your question, man?
Yes.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. All right. Yes.
Okay. Real quickly, I was at the Ocean View transportation meeting last night. We were talking about pedestrian access. Mm-hmm. But in that, we tried to figure out where all the beach access points were. And I've been saying this for 6 years. We can't figure out where the beach access points are. There's no map for it. There's no, I really think that's low-hanging fruit to your point.
Yep.
We don't have to do a massive investment. So I'd really encourage us to continue to think about how do we put money into marketing and communications. And then the second point is we've got to take care of what we have currently before we start putting money in all these new things. And that's what I think we all hear from our residents. We have a lot of trails. They're just really bad condition. Because they don't have the funding.
Yep.
Not because they don't want to do it, you just don't have the funding.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, let me ask, Andrew, what do you mean beach access?
The 7.5 miles of beach access points.
Where you see a boardwalk,
easy to find is what she's saying. They're not easily identifiable.
We
started putting beach markers on them on both sides, but we don't have the funding to do more. And they're not mapped anywhere.
The boardwalk's already there.
Yeah, they're there, but they're not mapped. She's saying.
You go on our city website,
mm-hmm.
it's impossible. You see a listing, bullets, but I don't know what that bullet point, I don't know where Albin Street is. It's not mapped to a GIS. And that's a very simple opportunity for us to take advantage of. But we should also have bike facilities at each of those. We should have places for people to park their bikes because there's not any car parking. So we just have to, it's low-hanging fruit. You know, we're the Mermaid City. Let's embrace our water access.
Okay. Ms. Johnson, then Mr. Smigel.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. So this was going to be a council question for me. But I'll secure your addressing. One of the things that we've heard from citizens are fish tiers. Being outside, being able to fish and crab, that is huge for the city of Norfolk. Many of us who have lived in Norfolk all of our lives, that is a part of who we are. And so it's not identifiable where the fishing and crabbing sites are. And the question for me is, do we have enough? Because that is something that citizens want to do. They're outside. It's a part of our heritage. It is a part of who Norfolk represents. So I would like to see, and I don't mind talking to Director Crittenden about this, more fishing piers and piers that can appear along the water way that are connected to communities. We have communities that are on waterways. I have five communities that are on waterways, historical communities that are on waterways, but there's no access to the citizens and the water. So I think that that's something that we can do more about cleaning up our waterways and having, providing access to that.
100%. And you know, it, because these are the big moves, it's not as specifically called out here, but as you think of activating the water, that's exactly that, right?
It's fishing piers. You talk of, you know, having trail access and having fishing piers or access to the water from there. Absolutely. So in terms of the action plan, that's where that's the living, breathing document. So any specific ideas you have, that's where staff can capture that. Based on the funding and the availability, those can be adjusted in the timelines. But you're right, the community said that, and it continues to be a priority, and it's part of history, so there's no question.
And so my colleagues, as well as the mayor and the city manager, are aware of when we also talk about trails. Our trails don't necessarily have to be just for downtown. The vision should be, how do we get our trails to be extended into communities, accessibilities, and communities that need more of that experience of what a walking nature trail and bike trail is all about. So that's the vision that we're working on. How do we take the trails that we already have and expand it into other neighborhoods that will make it accessible to citizens? How do we address the locations? And I heard you say it clearly. We have all these small centers. How do we address the location of future recreation centers, and how do we determine where these quote unquote possible recreation centers will be located within our city? What brings to mind, we have the South Side, what is known as the South Side. Don't particularly care for the word as it being described as the South Side, but we have communities that are divided by bridges and major highways in the city of Norfolk, so it's spread out. How do we provide accessibility for the people that are in Berkeley and Campostella and places like that, where you have a major bridge and major highway that keeps them from centrally located the city? They are a part of our city, but when you have infrastructure that is dividing or separating our city, how do we provide accessibility for those communities as well in our master plan?
This could take us the next 3 months to answer. But these are valid points you bring up. No, these are great questions you bring up, right? As a short answer, what I would say is, your equity mapping becomes the key, right? This is now a very objective way. You know, you rightly mentioned trails. If I look at trails here, you can clearly see most of your rings don't overlap. So you've got small loops in one place, but not something that's connected. Similar to the rec center conversation too, in terms of where some of these can go. This is part art, part science, right? The availability of funding. You have an existing space, we had funding that came through, and you decided to act, and this is great that you've got a library and a pool and a rec center happening. But as I look at some of these rings, proximity to existing ones that are going to be there versus others, that if you were to take one of these rings away, would that still ensure equity of access by virtue of another location being there? Then and only then does it make sense. Some of the others you've closed since the pandemic, you've not been able to open yet, and we may not be able to. So that's where, you know, there isn't one single answer as much as it's a series of different choices. but it's looking at your mapping and looking at your existing facilities, and the LPDA team's also done a conditions assessment, right? So there are some places we can look at and say, we're gonna spend way more good money patching something up that's gonna be needed to be fixed again in the next 2, 3, 4 years, right? Is that worth it or not? That's a question you'll have to think about. So lastly, in terms of people that are disconnected, I go back to the trail and connectivity part, and I go back to the hub and spokes model, is how many hubs can you possibly have that are these larger intergenerational multipurpose centers, and how many spokes that are the smaller neighborhood-based ones that you can have as well. I think the main thrust of this is that the way you've always done it will not allow you to succeed going in the future.
Mr. Mayor, if I have
one
yes.
more. Ms. Johnson.
The last thing is when you mention we talk about our parks. We have beautiful parks, and Mr. Cruz, and how many did I visit in one day? 8 to 10 in a car. I got to drive me around to see the entire city in the park. We have great parks in neighborhoods, beautiful opportunities. But what I don't see is the activity park. So the parks exist, they're there, and there's nothing going on. So there's opportunity, and it goes back to the funding for his department, as well as having people available to provide opportunities and activities in our park. We could do concerts in our park. We can have reading sessions if we partner up with the various other departments within the city. It doesn't have to solely become dependent on parks, your parks and recreation, parks and recreation, but I think we need to do cross, okay, planning with other departments so that we can bring about activities in our parks and they will come alive. And that will provide people accessibility for the things that you listed that you really want us, that you're recommending us to do.
Yes, and you should invest in letting people know that you are offering these concerts in the park as well, right? So if you have the staff and you provide the things, but then to your point, if nobody knows, did it really happen?
Right. And so I'm on the phone with my brother. Nieces and nephews are in D.C. now.
Right.
And they have all of these activities. Well, of course, I had to make myself known. We have lots of activities in the city of Norfolk, too. The people just don't know that we have this. The information isn't out there for them to have accessibility, and that they automatically know instead of having to go to just a website. And that has to do with us marketing our programs and what we offer in the city.
Absolutely.
So I defended the city of Norfolk to D.C.
Thank you, Ms.
Thank
Johnson.
You. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
You're welcome, Mr. Smigel.
Okay, so just forewarning, I'm going to be all over the place because I took lots of little notes. So some of this will just be hodgepodgey stuff. Your map on tennis courts, I had a little chuckle because they're not usable tennis courts. So you can put those circles up, but they're just not. And I know that Daryl and his team asked for $1 million, you know, just to fix what we have. But it goes back to what Councilwoman McClellan was saying about maintaining what we have and fixing what we have. But tennis courts is an issue. And it goes back to, you know, I have shifted my philosophy over the last 12 years on council from that we need to have amenities in every part of the city to going to the bigger facilities, and people are just going to have to travel to them. And I know that sometimes that creates equity issues, but if we fix our transportation in the city, then we can fix that. You know, we have scooters. We have other things now, too, that people are using to get to places. But I had to bring that up, so I'm crossing that off my list. Pools are becoming of more interest to me. I know you know I'm a high school principal. I also have 3 children. I think Norfolk is very inadequate in pools. We are not competitive anywhere in Hampton Roads when it comes to pools. Hampton, Newport News are beating us in that now. They're building new pools. And it was really upsetting to me that when over at Ward's Corner and the Norfolk Fitness and Wellness Center, that the community, some people in the community pushed back on having a competition pool there. And I just disagree. I'm gonna continue fighting that Norfolk needs to have a competition pool that could be multi, it's not just competitions on weekends. It can service your lap. You know, there's models all over that you can have multi-use with your pools, not just competition. And so I'm gonna keep on pushing for us to have a competition pool. Right now, our competition pool is in a high school that could be potentially torn down or rebuilt. So we don't really have, you know, that type of service. I noticed on your list, safety was one of the reasons why folks are not visiting our park. It was number three on your list. So this goes back to what we were talking about with cameras in our parks. You know, we just put a camera down at Community Beach to help. I think that was more to appease the people who live by the park than it was for safety, but it does help with that. And it goes back to, you know, we opened up beautiful Bay Oaks Park and the bathroom structure, and within a week somebody had vandalized it with paint. And, you know, we just have no eyes on the park, you know, and so we do need to protect our assets as well. We had the playground at Northside that was burned down, you know, caught on fire. We've had a couple of those. So I think that we really, just like we're investing in cameras and parking garages, we need to go ahead and start putting more money in the budget and investing in video surveillance. I know it's...
And park rangers too.
But I know that they're not actively monitor the cameras are going to be active, but they could help, you know, with this. So I just took a little note of that. We also need to continue working with the school system and missed opportunities. So when they built Ocean View Elementary School, it was supposed to have a walking trail around, and it was value engineered out. And we should have never let that happen. And so we missed an opportunity on your map where there's missing trails that could have met that need for that area, and we did not do that. I know Tarleton Park has been asking for years for a walking trail around it as well. Also a dog park, which there's none over on that side of the city as well. Going into your staffing issues, I think we definitely need to utilize our three universities and TCC more. If I don't know if TCC has a training program, but that might be something that we need to engage them in, and creating an associate's degree that leads to a four-year degree at one of the other universities. But I think there's a missed opportunity there if we don't have it. And sorry for my ignorance on that. I can't see you, Daryl, if you're nodding or not.
I don't think they have anything specific in that space.
But that might be an area to do. I know ODU has a recreation program, but how do we get people in that initial interest and then go into a four-year university? Mm-hmm. There. So I have some other things, but just I'm rambling. But I do have an important question for you, and it goes back to my interview with you about how we run our parks and recreation, and do we really need to be in the business of running sports programs in the city? Do we have to offer soccer programs, which right now Norfolk is killed in soccer compared to the surrounding areas? Do we have to run a boxing program? Do we have to run basketball? Do we have to run football? Or do we, in a sense, privatize that, but work with those groups to make sure that our kids have access to them if they can't pay whatever fees those groups are having? I just don't know if we need to be in the model of having to have a staff person that's running a soccer program and finding teams. I don't know. I would like to hear your thoughts on that, because there are enough private and neighborhood organizations that I think in Norfolk that could run these. It's just managing them the right way instead of us actually running teams. I think I told you in mine, I ran a soccer team with Parks and Rec. I was given the opportunity to go behind in a closet and pick out all the uniforms for my whole team if I wanted to. I don't think we need to be doing that. But I also am sympathizing with access, you know, for all of our kids to have sports. So is there a balance somewhere there with
so
that?
I'll give you a national overview, and then from everything I know of Norfolk, I'll speak more specifically as well. So generally, yes, you know, you need to be in that business by and large, most places, and the youth expect that. You're talking as a public safety, you're talking as a mental health, wellness, all the rest. That's a big part of keeping kids off the streets and out of trouble, right? Now, in terms of Norfolk specifically, for who does it, more and more where I've seen agencies have a consistent experience is when they do it in-house. You talk of going back to being a gold medal agency, or you talk of going back to what is the Parks and Recreation way. When everything is offered by those on the outside, if we get lucky and get someone like you, it's going to be great. If we get unlucky and find somebody who's not accountable, it's going to be terrible. As a user, I don't know the difference. So in my mind, it's the city's offerings that are terrible because of the one person that the city has limited control over didn't provide a good experience. Versus if things were provided by the staff on your facilities where you control the messaging, there's consistency in the offerings, then no matter where somebody goes, they get a high quality, inclusive, and welcoming experience. So I think that in general is where one would go based on some of the big moves. Financials always come into play, right? So those are more of the conversations you all have to have. But based on what I've seen over the past and now, and based on the vision where staff wants to go, and the community's expectation, I say yes to it. And where you can, if you as staff can provide that and ensure there is standardization in service delivery, there's consistency in messaging and the experience, everyone's going to be better off for it.
So then how do we fix that? Because say, for example, soccer is not offered two seasons. It's a one season sport through the city of Norfolk because I've been told it competes with football on fields, but we have a lot of fields. We can add more rectangle fields, but you know, how do we fix that? Do you have to have, I mean, Daryl, correct me if I'm wrong, but you would have like a bureau person that does like baseball and then soccer or something, but you don't have a soccer person. You don't have a baseball person. You don't have a boxing person. It's somebody in your department that has multiple roles and does multiple sports.
Our division of athletics is set up. We have a division head of athletics. Under the athletics division head, we have a senior rec supervisor, and then there are actually recreation supervisors and rec specialists. Each specialist is responsible for a sport. We have a specialist that runs football, and he can actually run basketball. The next specialist would do volleyball, soccer, and then the other specialist would be the commissioner over baseball, track and field, and another sport. So that's how it's set up.
Yeah, I'm trying to figure out, because this goes back to the root of fixing crime in Norfolk, okay, if we can get these, and I'm not saying you guys do a poor job at all on that. I don't think it's done 100% right. We've got kids still begging on street corners for uniforms through private leagues. You know, we've had issues where we almost thought about shutting down football for a season because it was getting too heated with parents and issues like that. I mean, there's been conversation. I'm just wondering how we get to the point where it is very structured and organized, whether it's a staffing issue, is it funding, if it's lack of fields, where do we identify where those fields are? I don't know where to go. I think this is though a big solution to problems with neighborhood crime. First, I think when kids have something more to do and it's more organized and they stay off the streets and cause issues, but it has to be done right. And I don't know if we're there yet with it. If it's a resource issue, if it is because we only spend $71, you know, whatever per person, then that's an issue too.
Councilman Spiegel, just to answer that, that is part of the reason based on what we spend per capita. The other thing also is based on the fact that the department over the last 2 years, in part of its master planning process, has had a chance to refocus, revision, and look at things. Hopefully next month, we bring back a proposal, a presentation on how we want to reshape athletics. And I think some of your questions with more competitive programs, making sure every coach has equitable knowledge, making sure everybody's certified, trained, how they even handle their fiduciary processes, all that needs to be taken into consideration. And that's what we plan on bringing here next month.
Okay, thanks.
It's a good point. I mean, I think we know there's folks out there doing good stuff. We we don't know all of them, and I think Daryl's team tries really hard to get with those folks. And in the bigger sports, I think we have a better handle on it, and we manage it pretty well. But I think it's a good question, and I think it's something the staff in Parks and Rec have said they want to get around. And there might be things where we realize there are so many good actors in a specific sport that we can pull back a little bit and just provide some oversight and some, you know, training and things. And it, to Daryl's point, a lot of them really struggle with the fiduciary issues, and so we could provide some of that. But we don't necessarily have to have the coaches doing it.
And I see that just at the high school principal level too,
yeah,
is that we're not competitive in a lot of sports. But if you go to like Granby's baseball and softball team, which had a lot of success this year and went to states, I'm bragging a little bit there.
Yeah,
sorry.
But
you
got a new coach.
Yeah. Right. If you go back and you talk to the softball players, the baseball players, many of them did start off in our little league sports and through Parks and Recreation and work their way up. Eventually their parents paid for additional training and stuff too, and good coaching. But also a lot of those kids were not, they're not involved in AAU or travel stuff either.
Right.
They're just, they are Parks and Rec athletes that had good coaches over the years. So I think it's something we just need to take a deeper dive in and look at, and it will help solve some of the issues we're seeing in some of our neighborhoods.
Okay. Courtney to Mr. Riddick.
I will quickly comment. I agree with Tommy and Martin. When we met, it was all about the maintenance. I was going to use the tennis courts as the example as well. So many of them are not functional. I can literally mow the grass on several of the courts at some of our high schools. And I noticed that somebody did actually last Sunday, because when I walked by it, it was mowed, literally mowing the courts. So I know we're doing $100,000, I think, assessment this year of our tennis court infrastructure, and then we need to move forward on really making this happen. But that's just one example where we have school tennis courts and we have other tennis courts, and they're equally not maintained, and not because Parks and Rec is not interested. It's truly a funding issue. So, and you know, actually, you know, pickleball is becoming very popular now. They want those lines drawn. It's just,
should have fixed the tennis courts first though.
Well, you have to do that before you put the lines
down. But we are yet still adding new facilities and new pickleball courts, but yet we're not maintaining what we currently have.
So maintenance is really that bigger issue, and just the opportunity for us to fund that more appropriately over the years.
Okay. you know, I think about when I came along, which is years ago, every community had a team. And City of Norfolk provided basketball jerseys, no shoes, at the centers that we played in, a couple of schools in Young Park Gym. The City of Norfolk provided total football uniforms except shoes, helmets, shoulder pads, jerseys, pants. And now we have a $1 billion budget, and we can't provide what we need for our children. You wonder why guys are walking around shooting each other, because when they're 10 years old, you don't cultivate them to play sports. When we came along, we played sports. The guys in Berkeley, they walked along the railroad tracks to Broad Park to play football. We had baseball teams from Young Park, and that we had played out at the field by ODU. If we knew we had a 5:30 game, we started walking at 2:30 to get to that game. But now we are not doing anything to encourage youngsters to participate. You talk about your tennis courts. One thing that I wish and I'm just hoping will happen, when you replace the tennis court in Broad Park, that you will use a clay tennis court. And I don't know whether the other courts are concrete or what, but Althea Gibson and Arthur Ashe used to play in Broad Park. See, Arthur Ashe is from Richmond, and because of segregation, could not play in Bird Park. So he had to come here and play, and we had some great tennis players here. And you know, you need to encourage the usage about pickleball. They gave us a pickleball court over in Berkeley. We didn't want a pickleball court. We wanted, you know,
a tennis court refurbished, but I understand that pickleball is probably one of the fastest growing sports in America today. That's when somebody educated me on that. But what we have to do, we have to stop being skinflints. We have to stop finding low-hanging fruit not to fund. And it's ridiculous not to fund things that were going to keep youngsters busy. And Sherwood Forest has to be probably one of the most neglected parts of the community when it comes to recreation. If you need to build a couple of more, just take a deep breath and build a couple of swimming pools you need to build. Sherwood Forest needs a total renovation, total pay attention to, and that's not my ward, but I know it's hurting. And then you need another pool over in Southside, over on the Berkeley side. As Tommy said a few minutes ago, aquatics is something that's really, really growing, and we just need to, grow with it. Now, what I'm going to do, Ms. McCullough reminded me that we had council concerns, so I'm going to stop talking there, and hopefully we can move into our council concerns.
Okay. All right. Ms. Royster.
Thank you so much for that presentation. I think it was really great because a lot of your recommendations actually echo the recommendations that came from our Social Economic Equity Opportunity Commission, specifically the youth and community engagement piece when they talked about recreation facilities. So some of the notes that I took is, and I like the, what you said, aging active, more multi-generational activated spaces, because I know in a lot of the conversations I have in community, they do feel like a lot of the recreational offerings are tailored to youth and young adults and children. And we have very active seniors who enjoy doing things too, as they told me. I also noted in your report the developing a technology team. I've been having the opportunity to do some research on various rec spaces across the country and how they're incorporating coding and drones and just, you know, even visual, what's the VC?
VR.
VR, yeah, virtual reality things. And it's not just for gaming, but also for exploration. They have like VR, and you can, you know, tour a museum or, you know, Italy or something like that. So incorporating educational opportunities with technology and collaborations with universities. And there are a couple of sites across the country where I saw where they actually collaborated with local universities. But they asked for the university is, in order for it to be a private-public partnership, is that something already exists in place? So I think to, you know, some of my colleagues' points as it relates to opportunities not just to collaborate with nonprofit entities, but with our university network as well, that was really strong. Accessibility, that's the biggest thing. And I know when we talked about safety, the first thing that came to my mind was Vision Zero. And if we're going to say you can utilize a scooter or a bike, we need to make sure that people are actually able to get to and from those places safely as well. I know one of the things we had discussed was also, to Tommy's point, he mentioned something about the cameras, but also the lighting and surrounding our recreation facilities, not just in the parking lot, but also some of those spaces. We have that beautiful new court over there, Dream Court over in Berkeley at the Southside Boys and Girls Club, making sure there's adequate lighting there because I'm sure people are going to be there playing at night. I would like to find out, do we have a quality report on what we have based off, you know, what Councilman McClellan was saying? You know, we have things, so is there like, you know, a grading table where it's an A shape, B shape, C shape, or it's a failure? So that way as we're assessing, you know, what gets done next, we can kind of have an idea before something else comes online. And also, I second the thing about partnering with some of these independent agencies who are doing some of the athletics. You know, Tommy brought up a good point. We constantly have people coming here saying, I do this with football, I do this with soccer, and I understand about keeping it in-house, but is there a way we could partner with them if they are meeting the fiduciary requirements background? And, you know, we can help them with some of the costs because a lot of them also have some of those great community relationships. And depending on how they're set up, if they're a nonprofit, they're also getting access to funding as well. The last point I'll make is youth voices matter.
So I'm hoping that we'll get an update soon on our youth council, because I think as we're making decisions for young people, our young people's voices would be very helpful in shaping the recreation center and open spaces for the future. So that's all I had.
Okay. All right. Mr. Thomas. Well, thank you very much. Thank you both.
Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Commissioner, thank you for being here as well. Kimberly.
Right. I'll get Kim to go through this quickly because we want to get to council concerns. But this is really important and necessary.
This is important.
It's all through the media. I know y'all are getting phone calls, you're getting emails, you're getting texts. The eviction moratorium is getting ready to expire. You know, that part is out of our control, right? I mean, we all recognize that as a governing body, that's not our decision. However, we do believe that there still are critical needs running around out there in the rental, particularly in rental housing, and folks that are in very high risk of losing their housing. So as part of the budget, you all included money to be used to continue some eviction prevention services. I have Kim Pierce here, who's been serving as our acting director for Department of Neighborhood Services, just to come in today and explain a little bit of the actual nuts and bolts of what we're going to do with the funding that this body provided with the budget. So Kim, thanks for being here, and whenever you are ready, take it away.
Okay, good evening, everyone. As Dr. Fowley said, I'm Kimberly Pierce. I'm the acting director for Neighborhood Services, and I'm happy to be here this evening to provide an update on the city's eviction prevention efforts. Next slide, please. So a little over a year ago, we came before council and we provided an update on our efforts at that time. And we mentioned that an eviction mitigation team had been created. And the team itself is created or was created and includes both external partners and city departments. Some of our city departments include Neighborhood Services, Human Services, the Department of Housing and Community Development, as well as Civic Lab. And then our community partners include NRHA, Norfolk Public Schools, the Sheriff's Office, the Salvation Army, and Four Kids, as well as many others. And so the committee itself, or the eviction mitigation team itself, is divided into three subcommittees. We have an outreach committee that is responsible for marketing of and education about eviction prevention resources. We have a legal committee that is working to identify ways the city can support changes to housing law to ensure that tenants have adequate housing protections. And then we have a data committee. And the data committee is looking at the data that we have and what we know to identify concentrations of evictions in the city to help with targeting our outreach efforts. And working in partnership, the legal committee and the data committee are working to improve ways that data collection comes to us through the courts so that it is useful to the city and organizations that are working to improve eviction prevention. Next slide, please. And so as we look at Norfolk's eviction rates, you can see that from 2016 to 2020, he hovered somewhere around 50%. In 2020 and 2021, evictions ordered decreased significantly, and this was because of the federal housing moratorium that was in place, as well as the subsequent General Assembly action on housing protections. So during the moratorium and with the housing protections, it was difficult to have an eviction occur solely on the basis of non-payment of rent. And so that is why we see that the number of ordered evictions has been significantly lower in 2020 and 2021. Eviction data that's available to us from the court records doesn't specifically indicate the reason for an eviction. But we know that because of the moratorium that has been in place, that it's likely that these evictions have been more about other types of lease violations. For instance, someone having an additional person living in the unit that should not have been there, or perhaps was doing some things that were not that were illegal from that premise. And so those may also be terms for an eviction. Next slide, please. And so I want to talk just briefly about our eviction prevention funding summary. We've received two grants from the Commonwealth of Virginia, the Virginia Eviction Reduction Pilot. We've had two allocations, as well as state and local recovery funds that have come to us locally. With these grants, we have been using them to promote eviction prevention efforts citywide. Next slide, please. So under VERP 1.0, the city received a grant award of $560,000, and we were able to help almost 300 households. And this included residents in public housing, specifically in the St. Paul's quadrant. We were particularly concerned with this group of individuals because we knew that with the development in St. Paul's, they would be moving into the private rental market, and we wanted to ensure that they did not have an eviction on their housing history that would prevent them from safe, adequate housing. Grant funds were expended in four major categories, and our largest portion of expenditure was for rental arrears, about $340,000, and our second largest expense was for utility payments, about $151,000. Next slide, please. And so with our current funding that's underway now, we have VERP 2.0 and we have the local investment. So with the VERP 2.0 grant, we are using these funds to assist with court navigation, working specifically with households that have already received a pay or quit notice or an unlawful detainer summons. With our local funds, we are focused more on housing stability. And what this means is that we are working with households that we know are behind in their rent, but have not yet received the unlawful detainer summons or the pay or quit notice. And so what we're trying to do there is provide assistance to get them caught up with their rental payments so that they do not have the potential for an eviction to occur. And under both of these opportunities, we are emphasizing workforce opportunities, which I'll discuss in our next slide. Thank you. So our current round of round of funding, we are committed to offering workforce opportunities to the households that we assist. Improving financial stability is critical to achieving and maintaining housing stability. With our first round of funding, we were focused on making sure that the rental arrears and utility payments had been made, but this time we are advancing our efforts by introducing workforce opportunities to all applicants, especially those that are unemployed or underemployed. We have established partnerships with Norfolk Works, with the Department of Human Services Employment Pathways Program, and we are also working with Bank On to provide financial literacy education. And so I do want to spend a moment and talk about the funding criteria. For a household, the maximum amount of funding available is $3,250 over a 12-month period. The priority for us is that rent is paid first before utilities, and although employment is not required, we do prioritize households with documented income because we realize that our best investments are sustainable. And lastly, to avoid duplication of service, we have applicants that have come to us that have applied to the state's rent relief program, and we have their applications on hold until they can demonstrate that their application has either been denied or that the funding that they received did not fully cover their rental arrearages. Next slide, please. And so I'll briefly talk about a few of the highlights and accomplishments that we have. I think Councilor knows that we've had two eviction clinics. One was in December of last year at the Addicts Theater. We had about 110 participants. And then just last month at Military Circle Mall, we had a second eviction clinic, and we had about 72 participants. We have an eviction action plan. We have updated the goals as an eviction mitigation team. And we have received eviction data from the Supreme Court of Virginia for the last 5 years, and we are using that data to help us with identifying the concentrations of poverty in the city by zip code. This will help us target our outreach to the areas that need it most. And we have also created the Eviction Prevention Center, and it is not necessarily a physical location, but it is a way for us to compartmentalize the work that we're doing with eviction prevention through the Department of Neighborhood Services and our partners, and giving it a face that people can recognize. Next slide, please. So the short-term outlook, and I think what Dr. Fowler would want you all to understand, is that we have the housing protections that are going to expire on June 30th. The housing protections that are going to be most critical to tenants are, number one, the 14-day pay or quit notice time period is going to revert back to 5 days. What this means is when the landlord or property manager gives the tenant their pay or quit notice, they will have 5 days to pay their rent in full, or the process will move on to court, or to an unlawful detainer and then to court. What this means is that you have now taken away an extra paycheck or possibly two paychecks depending on the frequency with which a household gets paid. And so now that option is taken away and it removes the opportunity for them to possibly pay their rent and get caught up. Also, when Virginia launched its rent relief program, they required that if anyone had applied, they could not be evicted within 45 days of that application. Which means that if they did wind up in court, the judge was going to continue their case because they needed time for the state to process the application and make a determination on funding. That will also go away on June 30th. So effectively, July 1, there will be no barriers in place that will prevent landlords and property managers for initiating the eviction process through the legal channels. And then the other thing that I would want to make sure that we understand is that once eviction is ordered and it occurs, we then shift from an eviction prevention crisis to a homelessness crisis. Next slide, please. And so moving forward, some of the things that we are doing is we are establishing a presence in the General District Court. We are going to be there in the mornings before court starts to help individuals that want to apply for eviction prevention funding with the city. We will give them a documentation that tells the court that they have applied for the funds. It will not say that they have been approved, but it will at least give them a measure or an opportunity to show the court that they are looking for a way to pay their rent. And if the judge and the landlord will be accommodating and allowing us to process that applicant through, that we may be able to provide the assistance they need to prevent an eviction. We are also working proactively to reach out to landlords and property managers. You all may or may not know, but the courts put out a docket every day of everything that's coming through. And so we have been looking at the docket in all of the unlawful detainer cases to see the property management companies that are most frequently on that docket. And we have begun reaching out to them in a proactive fashion so they can tell us who are your tenants that could possibly benefit from this program, given the parameters that we have in place, so that we can get to them before it gets to a legal process. And thirdly, we are going to look, especially using the local funding that we have, to explore opportunities for rapid rehousing immediately following an eviction. Housing stability is critical for everything. So if we can get to a place where we can work with a household and get them rehoused quickly, it then stabilizes them and allows them to move forward from that point. And next slide, Kim. And so I mentioned earlier that we had created the Eviction Prevention Center. We do have a telephone number. It's 757-664-6363. And they can call. We have staff that will answer the phone. We collect voicemails. We will return phone calls. And they can also email us at evictionprevention@norfolk.gov. And that is the information I have for you. I know I was a little fast, but I wanted to make sure I had time for questions, if there are any.
Ms. Doyle.
Kim, wonderful presentation. Thank you. That was great. A few questions. I didn't see legal aid as a part of the Norfolk eviction mitigation team. How are we working with them?
We work with legal aid throughout the process because we've been working with them as the
rent relief program was ongoing. We can make referrals to them when we need to. At the time that we approached them, they didn't have the capacity to commit to the time frame. So what we did is we reached out to Regent University's Law Clinic, and we have a representative from the Regent University Law Clinic that sits on the eviction mitigation team. But we do have a great working relationship with legal aid. We're able to make referrals and get information and guidance from them at any time.
I think it's great that you're going to be in General District Court because that's where the transaction happens.
Yes.
That's where someone says, now I'm at homeless.
Right.
And that's where legal aid stands there and says, okay, now what do I do, right?
Right.
So I think if we could really partner closely with them in that instance, so somebody's not walking out the courthouse without a home to go to, I think that's really good.
Okay.
And then lastly, how receptive are the property companies in terms of your outreach to them to say, hey, we want to help
we've initiated this process, we have found that some property management companies are more responsive than others. It really just comes down to what their need is at the time, how many tenants they have that they want to refer to us. But we don't give up, right? We try to continue to work with them. If they aren't responsive, we kind of put them on hold and move out to the next group. We want to be careful about how many people we bring in at a time because we have a small staff and we want to be timely in our processing of their applications. But responsiveness has been hit or miss with some of them. We have some that are very responsive and will get the names of their tenants to us and fill out the paperwork almost immediately. And then there's some that we're a couple weeks in and we're still asking, hey, who can we talk to?
How much of the 800,000 do we have left?
We have not quite started using the 800,000. We finished with the 560 that we got in the first round just in June. We are working now with the $200,000 grant that we got from the state, and we are going to begin working with the 800,000 probably before the summer is out.
That's great. That's wonderful. Thank you.
Okay, Mr. Royster, good to speak.
Yes.
Wonderful presentation. Thank you so much, Jeff. One of the questions I had was in regards to some of the cases you're seeing, mm-hmm. how would you say, is there a large percent that's due to landlords or property management companies dramatically increasing their rent? I've been getting some emails as it relates to people are private property owners where we've seen $700 to even $1,000 of an increase in rent,
mm-hmm.
and a lot of the persons on the other side of that are tenants and just in a place where they can't afford it.
Right.
So is that something that you're coming across?
Right now, no. The individuals that we are seeing are individuals that are in the middle of their lease term and have just fallen behind either because of COVID. They had a car repair that they had to make a choice between getting their car repaired and making their rent payment. So, no, we have not seen anyone that has come through because they can't afford their rent right now, other than the reasons that I just mentioned. But we have been listening, and we are aware that rent is on the rise. So a lot of what we are seeing is that a lot of lease terms are ending, and then the landlord or property management company is increasing the rent. But that is not necessarily an eviction, it's so much as they can't afford the new rate and they have to find somewhere else to move.
Okay, Mr. Spiegel,
Mr. Yeah, just wanted to thank you for the presentation. This is not every landlord or property owner, but some got hit pretty hard with this too. So we just want to keep in mind for some people it's a small business, and because of the allowance of not paying rent, there are some small business owners who owned an apartment building, it was like their first purchase, that lost a lot of money during this, and they did not qualify for federal money either. So there's another side to this. I'm not talking about the big SL Nuzbums of the world. There are some really good, you know, property owners that got hit hard by this.
That's a good point. What we've really tried to do with this new version is, and Kim mentioned several times, is sustainable.
Yeah.
I mean, we want to help folks. We want to help them right when they need the help, but then we want them to be able to pay their rent on a sustainable basis, right? Because we recognize that we can't, if we help them for 12 months, but then they fall behind again, nobody's benefiting from that situation. So
yeah,
I think it's a great point because we also can't lose this affordability in the housing market either.
Yeah, and that's part of what caused some of them to raise their rates, because when they were able to finally get an opening, they had to recoup some of the money that they lost during the pandemic.
You
and
can't
so
lose that affordability.
On top of inflation and everything else that happened. But the bigger companies can afford some of this, the loss of it, but there are some that cannot. You know, they're just the your one little fourplex owner, you know, or so, and that it causes problems for them.
And I will add also to what Dr. Fowler said, our challenge is that the small landlords are the ones we
can't necessarily identify in the docket. We can see who they are, but we can't get the address because that information is not available to us. But if we see SL Nussbaum or Mission College, we know how, but we can't find David Green. And that's the challenge that we're working on now, is to identify ways that we can find smaller landlords and property managers.
I think being in the court will help with that.
Yes.
Because, you know, you'll be there in the room with
I have no sympathy for slumlords though, that live in California and own apartment buildings on Pleasant Avenue and don't maintain them.
Councilman
Rick shared
your
sentiment
on that.
Ms. Johnson?
Director Peters, thank you so very much for the information. I know you're including Norfolk Works.
Yes.
But may I make a suggestion
Absolutely.
To also include the Workforce Council? Okay.
Yes.
We're very good partners with them. They're boots on the ground kind of people. They're looking to help people. So please.
I will reach out to them.
And I'll send the email on your behalf.
Okay.
So
thank
you're
you.
Good. The next thing is... one of the things that I found during the pandemic was
So when citizens received the notice and they were told that they were going to be evicted, one of the first things that they did was to move out and then contact someone such as neighborhood services.
Our landlord tenant relations officer.
Exactly.
Yes.
But the goal is to teach them, you got to get to us before it leads up to that.
Yes.
Also, and you can make correct me, the knowledge of understanding once you leave, you need a residence.
Mm-hmm.
She needs an address for these people. So once you move out, Director Pierce and her team and others no longer have a residence address for you to help you. So it's like you're not allowed that funding. And then lastly, Director Pierce, I heard you talk about property management. What I've shared with you and your team and Director Gallup as well is I'm seeing that some of the property managers, and I think it has a lot to do with the people who they have on site, unaware that they are infringing on people's Fair Housing Act. They are. They're crossing that line with people, and we've had to help them. And let them know you cannot do this. And should you move forward, then I'm going to have to take a position. And some of these property management corporations, we know who they are. So that's something that we have to work on as well. But thank you so very much. And tracking the data, doing the pandemic to find out. And we talked about it, Mr. Manager, exactly how many of these families we were looking at who were not paying their rent during the pandemic and knowing that it was a lot of people and that they owed a lot of money that has just built up over the time. So thank you so very much. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other questions or remarks?
So I do have one final thing to add, sir, if I could, in front of council. Kim has been serving admirably as the acting director with Michelle's retirement, and we did conduct a search, and I'm happy to say tonight that after 23 years of service to this city, Kim Pierce did accept my offer earlier today to become the new director of Neighborhood Services. So she will be sticking around for a bit longer, but I don't know that I'll get 23 out of her, but I just personally want to thank Kim for filling in and stepping in. It's been terrific to work with. I look forward to working with you going forward now that you are officially the director. So congratulations and thank you so much for agreeing, and thank your husband Curtis for allowing us to borrow you.
I will do that. Thank you all very much. I look forward to working with each of you more closely. Thank you.
All right, sir. We had the presentation between Pete and I on mini grants. I know we have some council members who have council concerns. We've got about 25 minutes. Pete and I can do that on July 12th. There's no massive urgency, so if we wanted to go around the table real quick, I'm happy to do that.
Okay. We'll start with Mr. Riddick and work our way around to Mr. Thomas.
You know, I think I'm going to pass because what I want to talk about probably should be done in closed session. It has to do with the police department. And I guess what I'd like to say is that I'm of the opinion that right now in Norfolk we are dealing with a white backlash. We've had the last four police chiefs, three of them been black. We had 12 years of black city managers. And so now there's a resistance that's building up throughout the organization that I think we need to talk about maybe in closed session, especially with the police department at a different time. So instead of bogging you guys down with that, I'm going to hold mine until we can get in the closed session.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Riddick.
Thank you. I wanted to bring up something that we talked about in 2020. We almost voted on it. And after the tragedies that happened in Buffalo and Uvalde, I'm so glad that we recognize Moms Demand Action, but we have an opportunity, a tool in our toolbox to, at least within city buildings, to ban guns and ammunition. And I feel very strongly that we need to do that. I would have added to that city parks and at event spaces, but because of the Supreme Court ruling from last week, I think that's a lot more tenuous now about our ability to do so. But even Justice Kavanaugh, in his opinion, explained the opportunity still exists to regulate guns in government buildings and sensitive places. He explicitly calls that out. So I think we need to bring that back up. I'm getting calls from folks in the community, and it's not just for our city council meetings, it's for the 5,000 employees that we have here in the city of Norfolk. And having just celebrated, not celebrated, commemorated the tragedy of Virginia Beach 3 years ago, the fact that we can't do that or we haven't done that, I think is irresponsible to our employees. And I would ask you, Mr. Mayor, to put that on the agenda to vote on soon.
Okay. Ms. Torrey.
I'm good, thank you, Mr. Mayor.
All right. Mr. Smigel.
I have a list. They're all low-hanging fruit things. And mostly just updates that hopefully we can get. Metronet, where are we with their installation? Can we get an interactive map maybe up of
they
where they are?
To put one of those up on their website when they started, but I will check. Pat, can we reach out to them and see where they are in that?
Yes, we will do.
And the same thing with Dominion Lights replacement. So if that it works out, I would request a map of where they're replacing those two.
Yeah, I will brief council on the Dominion Lights on July 12th.
Councilman Swigo, can I just add quickly to that? So Dominion has been very good recently replacing down light poles.
Yes.
Please make the request because they did them very quickly once they really knew the issue.
Okay. Chesapeake just passed cameras in school zones. I'm hoping to see something in Norfolk with that and doing some pilot places of that. So if we can.
The speed cameras.
Speed cameras,
yeah.
In school zones.
Yeah, interestingly, I did see a report today that folks are complaining that they're being billed and they're not accurate. But we've looked at the technology. There's different types of technology. Obviously, there's multiple companies doing that. So
I had a whole presentation on this about 8 or 9 months ago. We signed a contract with a company who's going to do that for us.
They can do speed cameras.
Yeah.
That is correct. The company. The company can do speed cameras.
No, I know. I mean, I read the stuff with Chesapeake, but. I think we have some pockets around Hampton Boulevard by Larchmont Elementary, Granby Street by Granby High School, Little Creek Elementary. You've got places that we have issues where Booker T. Washington, that, that I think that could help us with some of our pedestrian issues as well. Yes.
So if I could just add another point to that.
Sure.
Sorry, Councilman Swigel.
No concern, so you can add on to mine.
Yeah. So Vernon and team and others are coming together to discuss the process within the administration. So that has been on the radar for a long time, and now the team's coming together to find a solution to make it
there
work.
There is a different process for that ticketing with red light cameras and speed cameras.
Sure.
So we're working with legal on it.
Great. All right. So I was the one who requested that we put panhandling signs up at intersections. I know at the meeting that we were going to vote on it because of a vocal audience member, we changed our mind and took it off, but it was more on the wording that was on the sign and less on the meaning of the sign. And I know that some of you may not want them in your wards, but I am asking that we put that back on with correct wording and that we pilot it at some of these intersections where we are having issues with panhandling and it's causing safety issues. And so if you don't want it at one of your intersections, then you don't have to have it. But I think if it's just a language thing, can we please work on that and bring it back? You can vote against it or for it, but I've asked for this and it's been a couple months now, probably more than a couple months since it disappeared, and can we have it back?
Yeah. I'll give it.
It's not being cruel and insensitive. It's just the language, and put a phone number up there that people can call if they want somebody to help. Because you know, some folks that are panhandling don't want help. And I think it's important for, you know, people to understand that we offer services to help people. So, okay. Police chase, there was supposed to be a change on police chases and allowing that, and we were supposed to get an update. And I'm mainly talking about the ATVs and the four-wheelers, and that's one of the reasons why apparently our police are not doing anything, because they can't chase them.
So we've spoken to our caucus, the state caucus. You are correct. Legally, ATVs, motorcycles are included in the current regulations. ATVs would not be. And so there has been this kind of gray area legally as to whether or not our officers could in fact chase the ATVs under this current statute in the General Assembly. I believe there is an effort going, it's either going to come maybe through the PDC or through VML or something, to try and broaden that language to be able to do that. I'll work with Mr. Pishko on making sure we're clear about what we think we can do right now. And obviously we may have some time where we have to wait until the next session to perhaps get this language changed.
And there needs to be a balance with police chases.
Sure.
So, you know, it
can, I mean, we still have in the city, I mean, council will still need to reconsider the authority for chases. And we did have that conversation, and I believe that Interim Chief Goldsmith and others in the department are putting together a plan for what this could look like going forward, to alter that and allow more flexibility. Some of the other cities are also reevaluating their current chase policies as well. So we'll get that back.
Okay. The final one is, I know you put in some efforts to help with litter and with grass cutting and medians, but the medians are not looking good throughout the city. And
I don't think they put it in, Tommy.
Chip, I go back to where we have all cement medians, and I was told that Public Works is responsible for the grass that grows out. I mean, we've got grass growing out of some of those at intersections this tall, and that Public Works is supposed to handle that, not Parks and Recreation. I don't understand why we have a separation. If there's a guy out there with a weed whacker, weed whack the grass and get it cut, or put weed killer down, or, you know, if there's more environmentally friendly, pour vinegar on it, whatever you need to do, but it looks awful. And I'm saying this coming back from Florida, where when I was on vacation, everything was taking, I was so impressed at all different levels from the state. I think VDOT does a horrible job maintaining our interstates, and we need to go after that at all of our ramps and how they maintain those, compared to what I saw driving through Florida, Georgia, South Carolina, and North Carolina. We need to send a message to VDOT that we're not going to tolerate them not maintaining, particularly over by IKEA. It's so embarrassing when you go into our city. We have a lot of people coming in to go to IKEA, and it just looks awful. And then we're having to pick up the trash. You guys have done a great job with the litter crew. I know you're working on that still. But I don't know if we need to privatize some of this. And we've got all these grass cutting crews out there that might want to work and try to help this. But I've took pictures today that I'll send you, you know, just sitting at stoplights, just like, this looks horrible. And I don't understand why, how we're missing this. It's a low hanging fruit thing that makes our city just look so much better and gives us a better reputation of being a cleaner, better looking city.
Well, I'll get back with Daryl and all the folks, and we'll figure out. We are having a really hard time keeping up with the litter. I mean, it has spiked post-COVID. I mean, it is documented that there is just a lot more litter in cities than there was. And so we probably are understaffed in that crew from where we thought we would need to be. We have, I believe, Tristan, do we have a full crew, or are we still short a few folks?
We're still short a few, sir.
Yeah, but it's probably not even enough to keep up.
I could tell when that crew went through Southern Shopping Center. It was like traveling through there. It was like night and day when it came to litter. But within a week, it was back to where
That's
it was.
What
I get that. I understand
okay,
that.
So we'll do two things. Well, number one is we'll try to make sure we're identifying true hot spots and staying on top of them. And then number two, we may have to reach out with Daryl and work with his folks to make sure that we have, for the you know, for the problem that we have, are we gonna have enough people to help?
And then just add on there, shopping carts, particularly in Ward's Corner area, just when you go down Little Creek Road, we, our towing division, I think, somebody in Public Works used to go and collect those. I don't know what happened, if it was a legal thing or not, but we would have charged the grocery stores, would have to pay the city to come and pick them up from a warehouse if they wanted them back. We would load them on dump trucks, and then they would do, I don't know why that program ended, and it was when I first got on council, because it was a big issue over in Ocean View Shopping Center, but I can tell you, if you go down Little Creek Road right now in Ward's Corner area, you're going to see shopping carts all up and down in Debbie Park and Monticello Village. And it's a hazard, too. They blow into the street. It just looks ugly.
And I think, Councilman, they were picking them up once a week, but you had to notify them in order to pick them up. It was only once a week. So it just took a long time, and they just compile even with in between the week's time that they pick them up. So.
That's it. One thing.
Yes, that's really great.
I don't know what Ms. Johnson asked me today. Cemetery at the corner of Princess Anne Road and Tidewater Drive. About 2 months ago, as a result of a high-speed chase through Chesapeake, half of the
bricks are still there.
It's torn down.
Oh, yeah.
And we need to get that.
Yeah, we have a contractor on. It's just a matter of getting them in and getting it fixed. Yeah. So that's one where we don't have to procure it separately. We have a contract for that work. Those folks are just crazy busy right now. So, but we know about it, and we'll get the folks out there.
Okay, Ms. Johnson.
Okay, Mr. Riddick, thank you. I'll take that off my list, sir. Greatly appreciate it. The over and underpasses. I would like to see an inventory of the lighting with the overpasses and underpasses, and the cleaning of the overpasses and underpasses. Assistant Director Oliver Love Jr. has been working with me on that, and I don't want to have to drive the city and take pictures, but I would specifically like to see for Super Ward 7 overall, the over and underpasses, they're totally different than the rest of the city. They've never been washed, they've never been cleaned, nothing. And so the lights continue to burn out. So if we could check those, that would be great. And lastly, the other thing, that the big talk in the civic leagues are CROs, the community resource officers, that they are leaving the communities. That's what they're being told. Citizens are very concerned that the CROs are leaving, although they understand that we're undermanned. They do. But they're also concerned, well, who do they send their concerns to? They no longer have a connection between us, the police department, and the communities. And they were concerned that they were not notified that this was happening, that the citizens had no idea that this was going to take place, and it's very sudden. Many of them just received their brand new CROs, and within weeks, they're no longer their CROs, so they have nothing. So I think if we could send something out with Chief Goldsmith and you, the citizens would better understand what the purpose was. And that's all they're asking for is communication, because it was a surprise to them.
Yeah,
and then
it
they're
was
looking
a surprise
at me.
To us that folks found out, because I haven't briefed you all yet. I mean, that's coming up. So,
exactly. But for many of us,
unfortunately, I think some information leaked out to folks before.
Right. But for many of us, Mr. Manager, we could hold our own in the civic leagues,
yeah,
and tell them general information, what it all means.
but they really wanted to have some form of.
And we will. I mean, we will be very clear. We are going through a reorganization in PD to try and put more patrols on the street.
Yes, sir.
That doesn't mean that we eliminate CROs. I think that's the misinformation that's out there. It does change the current CROs and how they're policing in their communities. But Chief Goldsmith and I will get back in front of this body. We'll explain sort of what the reorg looks like and what the CRO process looks like, because it right now, it unfortunately, the impression is that there are none. And that's not the appropriate impression. It will look a little different, but it's not that there are no more CROs.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Okay. Right. Mr. Royster.
I always nice going second to last. I mean, everyone pretty much gets everything off my list. Thank you, Councilwoman Johnson and everyone else. So I have one that no one has said. Can we get an update on the Citizen Review Board?
Yes.
I know that we were presented with a draft, and then we received correspondence from some faith leaders and community leaders that provided some input, as well as there was a possible discussion of maybe having a community stakeholder meeting to get some input from the community, as well as CPE had some recommendations that they made. So if we could get an update on where we are with the Citizen Review Board, that would be wonderful. Number two, I have also, can we have an update on the business compliance unit? And has it been considered still, because I know I have brought it up and I believe someone else in regards to adding like small businesses like our, you know, Shop and Goes and Tiny Giants and things of that nature, where we're seeing some activity as well as just blatant disregard for property, trash. I know me and Martin, there's a particular place in our ward where that particular business owner has not been a great neighbor as it relates to the allowance of loitering as well as just trash accumulation, which is not aiding to our beautification. Third, an update as it relates to regarding the nonprofit application process for some of those monies we allocated through ARPA, that would be helpful. Another one I have is there any type of contract or a review we can have in regards to the Lime scooters and bikes? I'm getting lots of complaints about them being dumped in people's yards, as well as our waterways and ditches, and just it's becoming a hazard, and finding out what is the actual routine schedule for them to pick them up. As an experiment, I let one stay in my yard for 10 days until finally I moved it myself, and it remains on the corner. Another update, to Tommy's point, the Dominion LED light tracker, there's going to be some type of interactive map that would be helpful, as well as where we are as it relates to the rec centers being prioritized in that. And I know there was a discussion about us possibly also adding cameras around the rec center areas and our possibly the parks too. And I think that is all I have in addition to, nope, that's all I have.
Thank you.
Mr. Thomas.
Most of what I was gonna bring up has already been mentioned. I had asked Pete Urich to follow up on the panhandling signs. I'd asked Bernard to follow up on the speed cameras. With regard to the dirt bikes and ATVs, there is a state law that allows us to impound those dirt bikes, and that could be a tool for the prosecution of those criminals, but we need to pass an ordinance that allows our local officers to do that, so I've asked that to be brought to our attention. And then following up on the police, the changes from the police department, I've gotten also rumors that the beach patrols are going to be eliminated, and that's something that the beach communities are not excited about at all, so...
Might not be a good time of the year to do that.
Yeah.
Well,
look into that, please.
Yeah.
All
right,
we've
got questions.
So the challenges that we're having with the police department, I think as you're working on messaging to these rumors that are getting out, I guess it helps us to have fact from, you know, these rumors of what's really going on, and if we could get some better updates. And also, I know that the interim chief is really busy right now, but if there is somebody that when we get concerns from citizens about police-related issues, that we could send those concerns to if he has a assistant police chief or sergeant that's handling these, because they're, I think because of the shortage, we're hearing a little bit more from folks that they now have to call complaints. They're not used to that. So even if there's a fender bender, the police don't respond anymore. They have to call it in, those types of things. I think getting that out to the public with the right messaging would help us. I think most of the public's accepting the fact that there's a shortage. It's just letting them know what the new rules are of engagement with the police would be helpful.
Yeah, I appreciate it. And again, we have this all teed off and we're ready to talk to council members about this stuff. And then unfortunately, some information has leaked and some of that information is not even correct information. I mean, it's kind of things that folks have thought they heard and so we do plan on getting out a full document about what the reorg looks like, how it's going to happen, when, for instance, if we are going to, you know, reduce beach patrols, we wouldn't do that in the summer. It would happen obviously in the off season. You know, things like that are all the things that I need to talk to you about. So we'll get on that though quickly before more information leaks out that might be incorrect.
Okay. See you upstairs.